Hi friends, welcome back to our YouTube channel. Today we have to discuss about one of the most important concept in computer science and engineering is functional units of a computer in computer organization and architecture. It is one of the basic question every student of computer science and engineering branch have to know. Okay. A digital computer generally consists of five functional units. The first one is input unit, second one is output unit, the third one is memory unit, fourth one is control unit, and fifth one is arithmetic and logic unit. These five units can be collectively called as digital computer. Okay, a digital computer mainly consists of these five basic functional units that are shown in this diagram. Okay, now we have to discuss about each and every functional unit. First, we have to take the input unit. What is the purpose of input unit? Input unit mainly accepts the information from the input devices. Okay. Input unit reads the information that are entered from the input devices. The most commonly used input device is keyboard. Whatever the information or data that is entered from the keyboard that is read by the input unit. Okay. Suppose we want to give the information from the keyboard whenever a key 7 is pressed. Okay. The corresponding digit 7 is automatically translated into equivalent binary code. This equivalent binary code is stored either in the memory unit or in the processor register that are exist in processor. Okay, so 7 binary code is 0111. This information is stored in the memory or in the processor register. Okay. The remaining input devices are mouse, joystick, trackball. These three input devices are called as graphical input devices. The graphical input devices are, first one is mouse, second one is joystick, third one is trackball. Okay. Scanner is also one input device. Okay. Among them, the most commonly used input device is keyboard. Whatever the information that are entered by the user from the keyboard, that information accepted by the input unit. That information is stored in the binary form either in the memory or in the processor register. Okay. Next unit is output unit. The output unit is used for sending the output results or processed results to the outside world through the most commonly used output device is monitor and printer. Okay, so whatever the result we are getting after processing by the arithmetic and logic unit, that results are sent to the output unit. That output unit can display the output results on the monitor. The output unit can send the processed results on a paper to the printer. The most commonly used output device is monitor and printer. They are displaying the processed results on the monitor. They are printing the processed results on the paper. Okay. Next one is memory unit. The most commonly used unit is memory unit, because whatever the information that is read from the input devices such as keyboard, so that information is stored in the memory unit. So memory unit is used for storing both programs and data. So memory unit can be divided into two parts. One is the instruction part and second one is data part. In the instruction part, we are storing the programs and instructions. In the data part, we are storing the operand data. To perform the operation, we require operands. That operands are stored in the data part. Okay. Next one, the memory unit consists of two classes of storage. The first one is primary storage or a primary memory. Primary memory or a primary storage. Second one is a secondary memory. Secondary memory. Okay. So what is primary storage? So the primary storage mainly used for storing the programs while they are executing. So suppose we want to execute one program, that program is stored into the primary memory. So under primary memory, we are using RAM and ROM. ROM. Okay. So RAM is nothing but random access memory and ROM is nothing but read only memory. Okay. So primary memory is very fast when compared, primary memory is very fast when compared to the secondary memory. But primary memory, in terms of capacity, it is low. It is low. Okay. But secondary memory is slower when compared to the primary memory. But in capacity, in terms of capacity, secondary memory is large when compared to the primary memory. The examples for primary memory are RAM and ROM. The examples for secondary memory are, so magnetic disk and magnetic tape and CD-ROMs. They can be called as optical disk. Okay. So secondary memory is mainly used for storing large amount of data. So if you want to store large amount of data, we can use secondary memory. The examples for secondary memory is magnetic disk, magnetic tape and CD-ROMs. Secondary memory is slow when compared to the primary memory. Okay. Next one is, the memory can be organized in the form of a fixed size cells. That fixed size cells is called as word. Okay. The total memory can be organized in the form of fixed size cells. So each cell is called as one word. So each word can store n number of bits. Okay. So the words are generally in the form of 16 to 64 bits. Some words contains the 16 bits only. Some words contains 32 bits only. Some words contains 64 bits. Suppose a word is a 16 bit, that can store only a 16 bit of information. Okay. Word length. What is word length? The number of bits that are stored in a word is called as word length. The total memory is organized in the form of fixed size cells is called as word. A word can store n number of bits. Okay, that means word length means how many number of bits a word can store is called as word length. Suppose word length is 16, we can say that 16 bits of information that can be stored in a word. Suppose a word length of 32 bits means we can store 32 bits of information. A word length of 64 bit means we can store only 64 bits of information. Here, each and every word size is a fixed. Okay, that cannot be changed. Okay, next one, the time required to access one word of data from the memory is called as memory access time. So, memory access time is nothing but the time required to access one word of data from the memory. So, that time is called as memory access time. Okay, if the memory access time is slow, then that memory is very fast. Memory access time is very high, that memory is slower. Okay, so now another important memory is called as cache memory. What is the location of cache memory? Cache memory is also stored in, also there in the main memory. It is a part of the main memory. It is existing between CPU and main memory. CPU and main memory. What type of information is stored in the cache memory? Frequently used instructions and frequently used data that is stored in the cache memory. So whatever the data that is frequently used in a program, whatever the instructions that are frequently used in the program, that type of data or instructions are stored in the cache memory. It is located in between the CPU and main memory. So in terms of capacity, cache memory capacity is very low. In terms of speed, the cache memory speed is very high. Okay, so in terms of speed, first priority given to cache memory, after that priority given to primary memory, after that priority given to secondary memory. In terms of capacity, so the first priority given to secondary memory, next priority given to primary memory, next priority given to cache memory. Okay, sometimes registers are also used for storing the operands. Okay, so registers are exist in processor. Register accessing is faster when compared to the main memory accessing. So why? Because register accessing is faster. Because registers are exist within the processor, the time required to transfer the data from the register to ALU is very less when compared to the time taken to transfer the data from memory unit to ALU. So that means the distance between memory unit and ALU is very high when compared to the distance between processor registers and ALU. Okay, so the execution time depends on the distance between the ALU and the memory unit and ALU and the registers. Okay, so execution time is also depends on the distance. so that registers are exist within the processor, so that to transfer the data from register to ALU can take very less time when compared to transfer the data from memory unit to ALU. So that we can say that register accessing is very faster when compared to the main memory accessing. Okay, so this is the description about memory unit. Next one is arithmetic logic unit. So arithmetic and logic unit is used for performing arithmetic operations and logical operations. Arithmetic operations are addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, modular division. So these are the arithmetic operations. Logical operations are logical and logical are and not operations. So these operations can be performed within the ALU. ALU means arithmetic and logic unit. Okay. To perform the operation, for example, I am taking add A, B. Okay. So here add is nothing but we want to perform addition operation. To perform the addition operation, we can require two operands. That two operands are A and B. Okay. These two operands are stored in the memory unit. Okay. Now, to perform the addition operation, first of all, we can retrieve the operands from the memory unit. Okay. After retrieving the operands from the memory unit, that operands are stored in the registers. Once we are getting the operands from the memory unit, okay, that operands are stored in the registers within the processor. Once the operands are available within the processor, okay, that operands are sent to the arithmetic and logic unit. Now, we have to perform the addition operations once we are getting the control signal from the control unit. Okay, so then the operation is performed. After performing the addition operation, the results we are getting. Okay, that results are sent to the output unit. The output unit can display the results on the monitor. Okay, next one is last unit is control unit. It is the heart of the digital computer. It is the brain of the digital computer. It works like a human brain. The control unit can controls all the remaining units such as input unit, memory unit, arithmetic and logic unit and output unit by issuing the control signals. By issuing the control signals by the control unit, we can coordinate input unit, memory unit, output unit and arithmetic and logic unit. Okay, so the control unit can generate the control signals. By using this control signals, we can control all the remaining units of the digital computer. Okay, to transfer the information from memory unit to the processor unit. So, suppose we want to transfer the information from memory unit to processor unit, that is controlled by the control unit by issuing the control signals. Once the control unit can issue the control signal, the data transfer can be done from memory unit to the processor unit. The control unit can generate the timing signals. Control unit can generate the timing signals. Timing signals are the signals that govern the data transfer can be done from one unit to the other unit. Okay. So control unit can generate the timing signals. The timing signals are signals used for transferring the information from one unit to the other unit. Okay. Next one, the control signals can generate timing signals. By using that timing signals, we are transferring the information from memory unit to the processor unit and processor unit to the memory unit and processor to the output unit and input unit to the processor and also input to the memory unit. So the control unit can consist of a control signals or a wires. By using that signals or a wires, it can control all the remaining units of the computer. Okay. So without using control unit, we cannot control all the operations of a computer. So that control unit can be treated as a heart of the computer or a brain of the computer. Okay. A large number of wires are connected to all the remaining units of a computer. So that carries the timing signal, that carries the signals. These signals are used for timing and synchronization of all events of all units of a computer. Suppose each and every unit can perform one event. Okay. So the timing and the synchronization of all events of all units that are controlled by the control unit by issuing the control signals or timing signals. Okay. The timing signals can determine which action we have to take in. Okay. That timing signals are generated by the control unit. Okay. So this is the description about control unit. Okay. So this is the block diagram or a basic functional units of a computer, and we have already explained the function of each and every unit. Okay. The summarization of basic functional units of a computer is mainly the input unit is used for accepting the information from the input devices such as keyboard and mouse. Whatever the information that are read from the keyboard, that information is automatically translated into binary code. That binary code is stored in the memory or a processor register. Next one is output unit. The output unit is used for displaying the output results after processing by the arithmetic and logic unit. That results are displayed on the monitor by using output unit. Okay. Memory unit is used for storing the both programs and data. The total memory can be organized in the form of a fixed size cells called words. Each word can store n number of bits. So hence we can say that word length is n bits. Generally word lengths are 16 to 64 bits. Okay. The time taken to access one word is called as memory access time. If the memory access time is very low, then we can say that it is a fast memory. Memory access time is high, then it is a slow memory. Okay. So there are two types of storages are there. One is the primary memory and the second one is the secondary memory. So primary memory is used for storing the programs while they are executing. So there are RAM and ROM, random access memory, and read only memory. Secondary memory is used for storing large amount of data. Okay, for that purpose we have to use secondary storage devices such as magnetic disk, magnetic tape, and optical disk such as CD-ROMs. In terms of capacity, so secondary memory is capacity is very high when compared to the primary memory. Next one, another important memory is cache memory. The cache memory is located in between the CPU and the main memory. In terms of capacity, cache memory capacity is very low. In terms of speed, cache memory speed is very high. Cache memory can store frequently used instructions and data. Okay, next one. Sometimes registers are also used for storing the operands and also store the results after processing the operation. So register accessing is high when compared to the main memory accessing, because the distance from register to ALU is very low when compared to distance from memory unit to ALU, because operands are stored either in the memory unit or in the registers. To perform the operation that are specified within the currently executing instruction, we require operands. So to transfer the operands from memory unit to ALU takes more time when compared to transfer the operands from register to ALU. So execution time also depends on the distance traveled to transfer the information from one device to another device. So that hence we can say that register accessing is faster when compared to the main memory accessing. So the general purpose registers are R0 to R15. R0 to R15. So total 16 general purpose registers are there. They are used for storing the data. These general purpose registers are stored in the processor. Okay. Next one is, last one is arithmetic and logic unit. This arithmetic and logic unit is used for performing the either arithmetic operations and logical operations. The arithmetic operations are addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and modular division. The logical operations are logical AND, logical OR, and NOT. Once we are getting the operands from the memory unit ORR from the processor register, so we can perform the operation. That results are sent to the output unit. Then the output unit can display the processed results on the monitor. Okay. Next one is control unit. Control unit can be called as brain of the digital computer or a heart of the digital computer, because it can controls all the remaining units, that is function, input unit, memory unit, output unit, and arithmetic and logic unit. It can controls all the remaining units by issuing the control signals. Okay, by using that control signals, we can transfer the information from one unit to the other unit, and we can do the operation within the ALU. Without issuing the control signals by the control unit, any operation cannot be done. Okay. The control unit can issue the timing signals. By using that timing signals, we can transfer the data from memory unit to the processor unit. So control unit can generate the timing signals By using that timing signals, we can transfer the data from one unit to the other unit. So control unit governs the data transfers by using only timing signals. Okay, a large set of wires. Wires are connected from one unit to the other unit. By using that wires or signals, we can transfer the data. We can transfer the data from one unit to the other unit. By using that signals, we can control all the events that are performed within all the functional units. For timing and synchronization of all the events in all units are controlled by the control unit by issuing the control signals. Okay, so this is the description about functional units of a computer. So thank you one and all for watching this video. If you like this video, please click on the like button and share this video to your friends and classmates. And if you like this video, please subscribe my YouTube channel, Dibbela Srinivas Rao. Don't forget to subscribe my YouTube channel. If you have any doubts, please put your doubts in the comment section. I will clarify your doubts. Please click on the bell icon to get the future updates in my YouTube channel. Thank you one and all for watching this video.